So how fast is our CPU? How do we measure a CPU? So one way of measuring a CPU is by its throughput. So how many instructions can it execute per second? Modern CPUs can execute a whole lot of instructions per second. So usually we have some sort of prefix like giga in front of it. So a giga instruction per second is a billion of instructions per second. And what that works out to is that each instruction takes 1 nanosecond to run. And that is a very short amount of time. And if you have no intuition as to how short an amount of time that is, or how significant that amount of time could be potentially, there's a really great video by Grace Hopper, who's a very famous computer scientist, where she's explaining about a nanosecond and how much it can cost for something to require a nanosecond. And so I'll link to that video beneath this one. But this is the other way of measuring a CPU, which is how long does it take an individual instruction to run? So that is the latency or delay. And again, we generally measure these things in prefixes because the units are so small. There's a relationship between the throughput and the latency of a CPU. So the relationship is that the throughput is the total number of instructions divided by the latency of each instruction. And in some sense, these are sort of inverses of each other. Generally, the higher the throughput, the lower the latency needs to be. Okay, so the current CPU design is serial, one instruction executes at a time, and so the only way to improve this design and make it run faster is to run the clock faster. In doing this, we're limited by how fast the circuits can propagate and converge. So we're limited by the speed of light and specifically the speed of electricity through the circuits. So one way of improving this is, of course, to make the circuit smaller and smaller. This reduces the amount of distance that the electricity has to travel, meaning that it can travel faster. And we've done quite good at this over the past few decades. We've gotten down to very, very tiny circuits that can execute very, very quickly. But we are starting to hit some fairly fundamental limitations here, and this has really started to slow down. And the reasons for this are sort of beyond the scope of this course, but basically we've reached the point where signals bleed into other signals, and it's difficult to dissipate all the heat. And so it's just very difficult to, from an engineering perspective, keep making the circuits get smaller. So it's worth thinking at this point about alternatives. So if we're trying to make our overall CPU run faster, and the method for doing that up to this point has been making the circuits smaller, is there anything else we can do if we can't make the circuits any smaller? So it's worth pausing the video at this point and thinking for a minute about how you might approach this problem and what other ideas you might have for making the CPU faster. Okay. So the ubiquitous solution here, the approach that all modern CPU designers are taking, is something called pipelined design. And the idea here is that multiple instructions are going to be executing simultaneously on the CPU. So the CPU is no longer going to execute one instruction at a time. This is referred to sometimes as instruction level parallelism, because there are other forms of parallelism. And you'll learn about some of those other levels in other courses that you'll take here. But in this course, we're just going to focus on this form of parallelism. And hopefully this idea is somewhat intuitive. It's very similar to the idea of a cafeteria line or going through a car wash. If the entire cafeteria line has to pause while one person goes through it, it's not going to be a very efficient cafeteria line. Instead, it's more common to set up a bunch of different stations, and so you can have multiple customers being served at the same time at different stations in the cafeteria. And so that's exactly the concept here. So here's a picture of an unpipelined CPU. So all the combinational logic will run at once. Here's how long it takes for that to run, so 300 picoseconds. And then here is the clock register at the end, which takes a certain number of picoseconds to lock in. And so here's the delay, and here's the throughput. The delay is just the sum, and then you can calculate the throughput. So the diagram here shows what's happening in the system as three different instructions execute. So we have no parallelism going on here, so the first instruction just executes in its entirety, and then the second instruction begins executing, and so forth. And so hopefully you can see that at this point, what we would like to do is to have these boxes sort of overlapping in the vertical dimension, in the horizontal dimension, along the time axis. So that's what we do. We split the logic into various stages. So here we split it into three stages, and we connect all those stages with clocked registers. So here's stage A, stage B, and stage C. Okay, so what this means is that assuming that these instructions pipeline well, and we'll talk about some obstacles to pipelining here in a bit, assuming that everything is good, we can now start to overlap things. So the first part of instruction one runs an A by itself, but then once instruction one has finished that part and has moved on to stage B, we can now go ahead and put a instruction number two into the pipeline and have it begin executing the combinational logic stage A. And so those two instructions will now be running simultaneously. The first one will be in stage B, the second one will be in stage A. Once we get to the next time step, things get even more efficient because we now have three instructions in the pipeline. So the first one would be finishing up here in stage C, and then we'd have the second one here in B, and the third one here in A. And so then we'd end up finishing here. And so it's worth thinking for a second about the benefits and drawbacks here. So you should take a second and see if you can calculate at least the new delay, if not also the throughput of this new pipelined system. So pause the video and think about that for a second, and think about whether the delay and the throughput will go up or down, and whether that's a good thing or a bad thing. Okay, so the delay is certainly going to go up, and to see that, we just add together all of these numbers here. And so the thing that you would notice here is that we haven't decreased the amount of logic that we need to do, but we have increased the amount of time that we spend, you know, working and locking in these registers. And so it's not a whole lot, but we have increased the delay for each individual instruction. However, now that we're overlapping instructions, we get more instructions done in the same amount of time. Or another way of thinking about it is that we get the same amount of, we get these three instructions done in less time using this design than we did using this design. So either way, if you work through the actual numbers, this is what they work out to in this particular example. So you can see that even though we've increased the delay, which is generally a bad thing, we've also significantly increased the throughput, which is a very good thing. And so this exposes this classic system design trade-off of throughput versus latency. So in general, and to get higher throughput with these pipeline chip designs, we have to increase the latency. But of course, usually it's worth it because usually the gain, the increase in latency is small relative to the gain in throughput. But of course, this is something that the hardware designers are constantly trying to optimize. Okay. So, of course, the other cost here is that this also makes our CPUs significantly more complicated. You can see here that even the original sequential CPU designed for y86 was pretty complicated, but the pipelined one here is even more complicated because we've had to split everything up very carefully and add all these new clocked registers, and there's all these new things that we have to account for. And so that's the other cost of adding pipelining to a system, is that it increases the complexity. We are not going to be looking at the details of the pipelined implementation in this course. That's outside the scope of this course. The textbook does cover the pipelined implementation fairly extensively, though. So if you are interested, I would encourage you to read those sections in your textbook.